Says, "The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and your love will follow me all of the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. We continue our worship with the song of reflection.
I see.
first lesson today comes to us from Job chapter 19, starting in verse 23. Oh, that my words were recorded, that they were written on a scroll, that they were inscribed with an iron tool on lead, or engraved on a rock forever. I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand on the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes, I and not another. How my heart yearns within me. This is the word of the Lord. The second lesson comes to us from Revelation chapter 21, starting at verse 1. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who is seated on the throne has said, 'I am making everything new.' Then he said, 'Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.' He said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all of this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children.'" This ends the second lesson. The gospel reading, if you would please stand, is taken from the book of John, chapter 14, starting at verse 1. Jesus is speaking. He says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have not told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am." You know the place where I'm going. Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." You may be seated. Now, the scripture that I want to highlight or make a special emphasis on is Psalm 23. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want," in the King James Version. He goes on to say, "Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me." Now, I have to wonder if the psalmist David, if he knew what comfort those words would be to God's people and to the church from generation to generation, because they sure are comfortable, aren't they? King David, this prominent figure in the Old Testament, was a man after God's own heart. He knew that in good days, beautiful, memorable days, where you want to take out that Kodak camera and capture that moment, he knew that God would be with him. He also knew that in struggles, battles, strife, challenges, heartache, illness, that the Lord would be with him. David even knew that even if he should face death someday, that there was absolutely nothing for him to fear, because he knew, he was confident that his loving, compassionate shepherd would be right there, right beside him, to lead him home. And this analogy of a sheep being led by a shepherd, it reminds us of our complete reliance upon a God who knows his people and will do whatever he can to guard and keep them. He will do whatever it takes, even if it means laying down his life for the sheep. Now, over the past couple of years, I've had the honor of serving Richard and Glory as your pastor. It's an honor to do that. From what the family has described, Richard was a pretty shy guy, which, from what I knew of him, I could definitely see that about him. He was definitely more soft-spoken, and apparently he didn't get too mad at things. He can let a lot of things slide. He was very forgiving. He had a real love for music and would often reflect about his involvement in choir during his high school days. And if there was one thing he loved more than anything, it was his love for the Huskers. Yeah, he loved his Huskers. And for a number of years, apparently Richard made it a point to watch every game, not on TV, or to listen on the radio like some chump. No, he was there in person, joining the sea of red on game day. That's right, you can find Richard cheering on his favorite team right there next to the field. Now, something else that I loved to discover about him was his relentless love for his family, which I think he loved more than anything. Richard apparently didn't have a lot of family himself. He had a very small family growing up, and so being married to Gloria, he meshed very well with this very large Jensen side of the family. And they took him in, and he apparently blended in very well and saw them as his own family. Giving must have been his love language. You know, everybody has some kind of love language, something that excites them, and it's their expression of love. And for him, being able to give meant so much. Because anyone who had a need, apparently he was ready to pull out the wallet. Here you go. When the whole family was together, he wanted to be the one to give. And a few of you apparently figured out that if you had to go to mom and dad with some kind of question, there was somebody that you went to. And it wasn't mom. No, you go to dad, because you're sure to get a yes. He was the one who was going to say yes. I can tell as all of you reminisce about him, as you remember him, as you honor him, I do get a sense that there is a peace in your voice. Let's face it, this past year and really looking back, these past 5 years have not been easy, have they? And to make things even more difficult, COVID has really spoiled a lot of plans and a lot of hopes and a lot of being together. But despite all of those things, that's not where Richard is right now, is it? Richard is with his good shepherd. And this is what his good shepherd says in John 10. He says, "The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep." He goes on to say, "I came that they may have life and have it to the fullest," he says. Not just kind of have life, have it to the fullest. You see, we can have peace in knowing that the things that he struggled with, they're gone. They're no more. Because Richard is experiencing life to the fullest in heaven with his Savior. Because when his Savior went to the cross, what did he say? He said, "It is finished." Everything that's not quite right, finished. Everything that's not as it should be, everything that's not quite ideal, finished. Loneliness, aching bodies, failing memories, sin, death, the grave, all of it. He said from the cross, he said, "It is finished." And in this lifetime, the greatest hope that we can cling to, real, genuine hope, is in Jesus Christ. Because today we don't just celebrate the life of someone who was. We celebrate this man of faith who is with his Lord. A child of God who is reaping the fruits of his faith. And we know that in baptism he was sealed with the promise of forgiveness and life and salvation. So that whether in life or in death, he would always be with his Lord. In the Lord's Supper, Richard found comfort in the presence of Christ Jesus, knowing that nothing could ever separate him from the love of God. And in all of those things, God prepared him for this day when he would finally be with his God in his eternal kingdom. I pray that Richard's faith is a testament to you as well. Because even as we say goodbye to a husband, a father, a grandfather, a brother, a friend, well, goodbye is not really goodbye forever, is it? We will see him again. You will see him again. Because for those who believe in the promises of Jesus Christ, you too will give him that big hug that you've longed for. You'll enjoy his presence once again, and you will celebrate a grand reunion with all of the saints in heaven and with Richard. You'll be able to catch up with him after a long time, but it will happen. Revelation 21, verse 4 talks about that day. It says, "And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain." He says, "For the old order of things has passed away." That's our future. That's our promise. You see, for those who are in Christ Jesus, death does not define our destiny. Death doesn't have any kind of final say over us, because our good shepherd walks with us even through the valley of the shadow of death. And as he walks with us, that's how we can have peace. We can commit our brother to the Lord, knowing that he is in the best place of all, isn't he? In closing, I want to reflect on those words from David just once more. Psalm 23. He says, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all of the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Amen. Would you pray with me? Father, it is with heavy hearts that we come before you today. But we pray that you would meet us in our sorrow and lift our eyes to the peace of your constant presence. Help us to hear your word of grace so that our hope might be renewed by your promises. Father, you didn't design us for darkness and pain and death, but rather for the beauty of life, for the fullness of life, as Revelation says. And so we thank you that your Son paid the ultimate cost that we might experience life everlasting. Certainly as we weep and we mourn today, we pray that our hearts might be comforted with the hope of resurrection. As our brother Richard has passed, remind us once again of the day in which we will be reunited with him. And as we wait for that day, give us your strength and your peace to bear these days ahead, so that we might find your joy once again. Father, heal our hurt and lead us to the joy of your salvation. All of this we pray in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. 1 Corinthians, verse 15, chapter 15, starting at 51, says this. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye. At the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with imperishable, and the immortal with immortality. And when the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. May God the Father, who created Richard, may God the Son, who by his blood redeemed him, may God the Holy Spirit, who sanctified him to be his own, keep him to the day of the resurrection of all flesh. Amen. As we say on Easter, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. And so let us go forth in peace, in the name of Christ. Receive the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. Here in just a moment, we're going to invite the family to leave during a song. But before we do so, just a quick announcement. First of all, immediately following this ceremony, we're going to meet out at Memorial Cemetery. So we're going to form a procession. And so as always, turn on your blinkers. That lets other people know that you're part of that line. And we'll all be safe with that. And another thing, I just want to just say a word of thank you on behalf of the family, and especially on behalf of Gloria. Just thank you so much for your love, for your support, and being here today. It means a lot to the family. So thank you so much.